Wherever we are, the breathing is here. A reminder to be present to the natural processes of life. And to explore what it is to breathe without a breather. Tonight I'll take 40, 45 minutes to speak on the topic of livable societies, the Dhamma of livable societies, and then hopefully have some time at the end if there are any questions that you have. Often when I'm asked to speak about engaged Buddhism, I talk about Dhammic socialism, which is a term Ajahn Buddhadasa coined back in the 70s when Thailand was on the front lines, more or less, of the Cold War. The Vietnam War was going on, and the ideological and violent competitions between capitalism and communism. And due to the propaganda and the military stuff of the time, it was rather dangerous to be socialist and to be accused of being a communist. Could cause you a lot of trouble and even get you killed. Ajahn Buddhadasa was accused of being a communist. Fortunately, the people who investigated had enough brains to realize that that was stupid. Not that he was a big fan of capitalism either, but the government recognized that it was just conservatives in the Thai Sangha who were trying to get rid of him, and they didn't take it seriously. So that's a little background to tell you I'm not going to talk about Dhammic socialism, partly because there are books on it, and I've talked about it many times. Actually, I'll be talking about it, but not using that term. Instead, what I'd like to do is bring to mind certain things that Ajahn Buddhadasa mentioned that I heard him speak about in talks, or read in a book, or even had the opportunity to discuss personally. And I want to do this because whenever I speak here, I want to make the talk an opportunity for people to hear more about Ajahn Buddhadasa in English, especially things that aren't readily accessible if you don't read Thai. So I'm going to draw on certain things that he mentioned in his talks, a number of them drawn from the Pali Suttas of Theravada Buddhism. And I'd like to use these perspectives to encourage us to imagine what a livable society might be. Over the years, I've been prone to be critical of existing societies, such as the one where I grew up, the United States, and one where I spent 20 years, Thailand. These days, I'm less interested in my criticisms. So they may sneak in because it's an old habit. But instead, I'd like to encourage us all to imagine societies that are worth living in. And I'd like to offer some Buddhist perspectives on that, especially ones I think Ajahn Buddhadasa would share. One aspect of a livable society is that awakened teachings would be available. This is an old concept or perspective in Buddhism, that after a period where the living teaching of a Buddha, of an awakened one, is absent, a Buddha will emerge. And then during the lifetime and for a certain period after, those awakened teachings will be available. Now here I'm drawing a distinction between what we might call ordinary ethical religious teachings, such as the usual stuff about being good and not killing people and stuff like that, which is important and necessary. But for Ajahn Buddhadasa, being good and not killing and stealing, being nice and friendly, all of those are great things, but they don't liberate us. They just give us good egos, nice egos, friendly egos, which can also entrap us in the suffering of being good, nice, and friendly. The livable society that I'm looking for, and I would say these days it's not completely absent, is it's not too difficult to find liberating teachings. But I encourage you to reflect on this because, say, take the average Buddhist country and the average Buddhist temple. One might expect, although expectations are never wise, that in Buddhist countries, the teachings of the Buddha would be widely available. That's not always the case. There'll be stuff that you're told is Buddhism, but it may not correspond with the record we have of what the Buddha actually taught. Or there's been a selection process where the teachings of the Buddha that are talked about publicly are the more ordinary ones, again, being a good, ethical, kind person. But there's a whole lot more to what the Buddha was about than that, especially because being good and nice and ethical isn't particularly Buddhist. It's something Buddhism shares with many traditions, including certain forms of communism, or the 12 steps of AA and numerous other things. The really livable society that I'm imagining is one where the liberating teachings are fairly widely available. And that's easier to imagine, maybe, than to do. In the States, we have a growing number of meditation centers. But it's not always the case that one will hear the core liberating teachings. it's the case in some places, but not always. So things like this I see as a work in progress, and it's something Ajahn Buddhadasa dedicated his life to, as he often put it, to help people to understand the heart of Buddhism, not the ordinary ethical nice person teachings, which are, again, are essential or necessary, but they're not the real core and heart of Buddhism. Another thing that Ajahn Buddhadasa liked to mention, which is based in a quote from the Pali Suttas, and this is my kind of adapting it for tonight's topic, that a livable society would, and here's to quote the Buddha, not be empty of arahant. Arahant is the conventional term for the concept of a liberated being. So in addition to liberating teachings, a livable society would actually have living human beings who can model liberation in how they live, how they treat others, how they behave, how they speak, and so on. So there's a reference to, the actual quote is the world. But world doesn't mean what it means in normal English nowadays. And I'm not going to go into that right now, but anyway, it's close enough to society today. A livable society will not be empty of liberated men and women, monks, and although this is a little controversial in Orthodox Buddhist circles, I would say lay people and ordained people. If society is not lacking in liberated persons, humans, then the rest of us will have some really great examples. I'm not competent to say whether Ajahn Buddhadasa was fully liberated or not. I think he's the most liberated person I've ever met, but I'm not competent to judge, and it's also not the kind of thing you want to waste your time trying to judge, because that's another dead-end ego trip. But to have somebody who, on a fairly high level, models liberation is powerful. Such people are inspirations to the rest of us. They give us more confidence that it's possible. There will be plenty of messages that it's not possible, and our own doubting minds will regularly raise objections about why just go back to bed or have another beer or watch TV instead of meditating or whatever. So to have the powerful inspiration of liberated ones, arahant, And there's a way that the presence of Arahant also, I think, touch our own potential for awakening, which is another issue that Ajahn Buddhadasa, perhaps more than anyone in the last 100 years of Thai Buddhism, would touch on. There's a certain way that traditional Buddhism assumes that most of us don't have the capacity. That's only for special people. Ajahn Buddhadasa put a lot of effort into, in various ways, pointing out to anybody who would listen, regardless of your religion, nationality, whether you were male or female, monk or nun or not, that the potential for liberation is in all of us. And although this isn't tonight's topic, let me add, the potential is here right now. Liberation can happen right now. In fact, it never happens in the future. If that doesn't make sense, I'll leave it for you to chew on, so I can move to my next point. A livable society will offer religious and spiritual freedom. I come from a country where religious freedom is pretty well enshrined in our constitution and in many laws and legal decisions. But I also live in a part of the United States where some people, not me, because maybe I'm stupid or overconfident, but some people would be not feel comfortable letting it be known that they're Buddhist. There's a certain resurgence of a kind of religious narrow-mindedness that makes it uncomfortable for people who don't follow that religion to be open about say being Buddhist or Muslim or Wiccan or whatever. So for me, it's not something to be taken for granted, even in a country that at times has really stood up for religious freedom. Or even in Thailand, that has historically been pretty open, but there's also been times where it hasn't been as open. So for me, and I think Ajahn Buddhadasa would agree, partly what he did and accomplished in his life meant running up against a lot of accepted orthodoxies. Thai Buddhism isn't a heavy fundamentalist approach to religion, but still, within the monastic hierarchy, there was, I don't know if this is still the case, a fairly enshrined way of understanding Buddhism. And Ajahn Buddhadasa felt that, unfortunately, some of that was at odds with what the Buddha actually taught. And he fortunately, partly because he lived in southern Thailand, had enough freedom, and also his personality of being somewhat willing to say things that nobody else would say. He had enough freedom, and he took the freedom that was available to actually rethink a lot of Thai Buddhism or Theravada Buddhism. This has not always been the case in Buddhist countries, including in very recent history. And of course, it's not just about studying and having the freedom to study and think, to find one's religious path, to find teachings and perspectives that touch us, inspire us, and resonate with us. It's also the freedom to practice and the freedom to be different. Ajahn Buddhadasa did a number of things that were different. Suan Mok actually created a lot of space for others to be different. And I think it's to the credit of Thai culture, Thai society, and Thai Buddhism that even though there were people who tried to get rid of him, there was enough, in general, there was enough openness in Thai society, in the Thai monastic hierarchy, even in the royal family, which is generally a very conservative institution, that he was able to do things that not, maybe nobody else was doing. He was able to say things that shook things up. I can't imagine a livable society that doesn't allow such freedom. I don't practice the religion of my family. Neither do any of my brothers and sisters. I'm the most religious one, but it's not the religion of my parents and grandparents. And yet, my family and still enough of American society gives freedom. That still seems to be the case here, except with the caveat that I would say in countries like America and here, the pressure nowadays is not to be Christian as much as to be capitalist. Where in the States, we've entered December where the religion is really shopping and consumption, and by the end of the month, producing massive amounts of garbage and all the problems that come from that. So, also, I want to bring up the possibility that the issue of religious freedom may not be in terms of something like Christianity or Islam, but in many places it's the modern consumer society and the huge pressure to conform to the values of that society. I said I'd try to avoid critique, so I'm not going to push anything on this, but I do want to open some perspectives for reflection. Again, about imagining what is a really livable society. Here's another one that is something Ajahn Buddhadasa commented on a number of times. A livable society will be cooperative more than competitive. The major ideological system of the world today involves a belief in competition. everything will be sorted out in the marketplace and so on. And I'm not against marketplaces, but the idea that that's the arbiter of everything and that competition is the way to find out what's good and beneficial and true, etc. That never made sense to Ajahn Buddhadasa. You won't find it in the Buddha's teaching. But what you will find is cooperation. Back in the days when he was talking about Dhammic socialism, Ajahn Buddhadasa would talk about cooperatives. Here in Thailand, that was largely a German-funded thing, one of the German contributions to Thai development aid was trying to foster a cooperative movement on the German model. And so that word sahagon in Thai was a big word, especially when I came here and was involved in development work in the 80s and somewhat in the 90s. So cooperatives were being encouraged all over the country with mixed motivation. So Ajahn Buddhadasa, like with many things, would play with that word and say things like, if we observe, nature is a cooperative. Now, we've all heard the neo-Darwinistic, you know, nature is just, what is it? I think Hobbes, red in tooth and claw, it's dog eat dog, it's a rat race, you know. We project our human stuff onto animals and make them out to be nasty to justify, guess what? Ajahn Buddhadasa's perspective was that fundamentally nature is not competitive, that fundamentally nature is cooperative. Otherwise, it wouldn't survive. If we look at, you know, individuals or species in a narrow way, it's possible to insist that it's through competition. But when you step back and watch how ecosystems function, how villages function, and I would say societies, cooperation is more important than competition. I'm not ruling out certain forms of competition, but when they're excessive, then at least for me, that's not going to be a livable society. I'm coming from a country that is so stressed out. The incidence of cancer, mental illness, et cetera, is growing. And you can look up the medical statistics and if you need to. And so, to me, livable means cooperative. Another aspect of a livable society is that it will encourage us in virtues, or to use the more Buddhist term, although I should say Indian term, a society that encourages us in dhammas rather than in kilesa, defilements, self-centered, reactive states and habits of mind. It's easy to do some comparisons, the standard kilesa or selfish internal states are greed, hatred, delusion, things like fear and envy and pride can be added to that list. To me, a livable society, instead of encouraging greed, hatred, delusion, fear, envy, pride, whether on the individual level or collectively, certain forms of nationalism, for example, or certain forms of collective paranoia, which tend to surface from time to time. I think that's been happening in the United States. And if you follow the news, especially since having a black president, certain kind of paranoia has been increasing. A livable society, on the other hand, will be encouraging, say, rather than greed, simplicity, rather than the accumulation. And there's a sutta that talks about this. Something is Dhamma when it encourages non-accumulation rather than accumulation. That encourages sharing, generosity, rather than greed. A society that encourages kindness, compassion, and caring rather than anger and hatred. I don't want to be overly simplistic and argue that a livable society needs to eradicate anger and hatred or greed or fear. But I'm speaking more of the balance, which predominates. A livable society, to me, the encouragement of kindness and compassion will be stronger than the encouragement of anger and hatred. A livable society will encourage thoughtfulness, intelligence, not fancy schmancy, overly sophisticated intelligence, but what I would call the natural intelligence that's available to everyone, including PhDs, but it's not limited to that sort of thing, rather than delusion. What goes on in schools, what goes on in mass communications will really foster thoughtfulness, reflection, a certain kind of critical awareness where people are really encouraged to think for themselves rather than to react in knee-jerk ways, to jump on whatever ideology is dominant and feel obligated to go along. But instead, we're really encouraged to be intellectually mature. And this is encouraged in Buddhism, at least originally, if you go back to the Buddha's teaching, the ability to ask questions, to think about the questions, to explore the possible responses. It's not just about meditation and, you know, the rather impossible idea to stop thinking, which is kind of like spiritual lobotomy. There's a place, of course, for quieting the mind, but there's also the encouragement of thoughtfulness and intelligence. The livable society encourages faith. Of course, in Buddhism, not blind faith, but the capacity to find things that are worth respecting and having confidence socially, meaning that there are actual institutions that we can have confidence in. the livable society will encourage courage. And excuse me for being a little on the verge of criticisms, not the sort of thing where you take a gun and shoot people who don't have guns, i.e. drop bombs and drones on their heads when they can't fight back. That's fear. That's not courage. And so to me, a livable society will really express courage rather than perpetuating and increasing fear. And I could go on with antidotes to envy, to values in Buddhism like appreciating what we have. And instead of envying others what they have, being happy at the accomplishments, the well-being of others, especially when they've acquired them through hard work and in honest ways. So you can, of course, take this into whatever detail you might want. But my basic point, again, is a livable society will encourage us in virtue, in Dhamma, in healthy values, rather than primarily encouraging defiled, destructive values like greed, anger, hatred, delusion, confusion, narcotization, just kind of, you know, doing things so we're not really paying attention to what's going on inside us or in people around us and so on. And values, healthy values, rather than fostering fear. My last point is a livable society will benefit us more than it oppresses us or takes advantage. This is just the foundation of basic Buddhist ethics. The Buddhist notion of sila, which we can translate ethics or morality, is basically about non-harming. And the word ahimsa, or Gandhi used the Sanskrit term ahimsa, but in Pali it's usually ahimsa, means non-harming, non-hurting, non-oppression, non-abuse. For some of us who live with a certain amount of privilege and have had opportunities for, say, a college education, to get middle-class jobs, and to enjoy some of the benefits of the modern consumer society, we may feel that society is benefiting us. And that may be the case. But for me, livable is not just materially livable. Of course, we need basic food, clothing, medicine. But livable is also psychologically livable. And especially spiritually livable. For Ajahn, I'll focus on the spiritual part. For Ajahn Buddhadasa, that would mean a livable society discourages selfishness. The more that selfishness is encouraged, the more we are wrapped up in our own selfishness. And spiritually, that's death. You may be walking around, you may be eating good food, might have a nice car, But if internally what's running the show is selfishness, that's not livable, not spiritually. And it's pretty stressful, except we may be so wrapped up in getting stuff that we don't notice what it's doing inside. A society that truly benefits us will really encourage us, but not try to force us. It's an important point, because that's where some of the healthy ideas of socialism have gone wrong, when force was used to make us into good communists or whatever. So it's not about force, but encouragement or supporting us to really benefit, not only materially, but psychologically and spiritually. And so the advantage of such a society is that, and not all social theorists believe this is possible. I personally don't even know if it's possible. Though there seem to have been societies that for a while approached some of this. That when a society is based in, I don't want to say selfishness, selflessness, because that might be asking too much, but when there's a good amount of unselfishness, of caring for each other, then the advantage for society is possibly a decrease in the amount of resources that go into prisons, weapons, the amount of money spent on drugs to deal with mental, emotional issues. Healthcare might be simplified. So there might actually be material benefits. I believe so, though right now it might be hard to prove. I think a livable society will not take advantage of us to keep the wheels of society turning. Often that means keeping the wheels of power in the hands of those who already have it. And then the rest of us are manipulated one way or another, or at times even threatened with violence if we don't play along. A livable society won't do that. It won't take advantage of us directly in a violent way or indirectly in a manipulative way. And to me, spiritually, when we're being manipulated or coerced, it really stirs up our ego mechanisms, which makes it even harder to go deeper into Dhamma practice. There's always the gifted few who can rise above the usual manipulations and things. But it makes that kind of stuff makes it a lot harder for many of us. When society is really looking out for our psychological and spiritual benefit, as well as material and biological, then there's less pressure on us to react to things like coercion and manipulation And that energy then can be channeled into our own benefit, which in Ajahn Buddhadasa's thinking means what's really of benefit to us is what's of benefit to others as well. If something benefits us and harms others, ultimately it's not to our benefit because we're shooting ourselves in the foot. And it works the other way as well. And you'll hear the Dalai Lama and others making the point in their own ways. So these are some thoughts on a livable society, drawing on things Ajahn Buddhadasa has mentioned over the years, and most of these rooted in the teachings of early Buddhism. So to quickly recap, a livable society will make awakened teachings widely available. You won't have to look really hard to find them. A livable society will not be empty of arahant, of liberated people. A livable society will offer true religious and spiritual freedom. And that means freedom from ideologies that may not be overtly religious, but still can act much like religions. A livable society will encourage cooperation more than competition. A livable society encourages healthy virtues that support Dhamma life, Dhamma practice, both individually and in groups, in communities, rather than preying on our tendencies to fall into greed, hatred, and delusion. A liberative society will benefit us rather than take advantage of us and oppress us. In closing, and again to borrow from Ajahn Buddhadasa, this kind of society is normal. Now, the way the word normal is often used in English now, many people would not immediately agree. But from the perspective of Buddha, the awakened one, normal is not what a lot of folks today take to be normal. Normal, the Pali word is pakati, and the modern Thai word pakati or bokati is derived from this. But bokati in modern Thai means kind of ordinary, normal, usual. And so the Buddha's meaning tends to be lost. Pakati is the natural, it's the normal of nature. And especially when seen from the awakened perspective. This is something Ajahn Buddhadasa liked to talk about, because you can easily think of all the things that you or your friends or society in general assumes to be normal. In the Buddha's perspective, a lot of that is abnormal. And I encourage you to look at things from the Buddha's perspective and consider what is normal to a Buddha. And if we begin, the more we do that, the more livable our families, our workplaces, our friendships, our communities, and maybe even societies. I'm a believer of bottom up. I don't have much trust in top down because it's so often coercive and violent. But what I see working, including in what's worked over the years in Ajahn Buddhadasa's work, is just starting with a few people cooperating, helping, inspiring each other. And so each of us in our friendships, if we go looking and if we ask and reflect, what is normal from a Buddha's perspective? Even just to think about that can be fun. There'll be people who think you're naive or stupid. But to me, that's where we can have hope in societies that are more genuinely and more thoroughly livable. Not just about surviving physically, but surviving spiritually. So that concludes my prepared thoughts, and there's time for questions or comments. Don't feel obligated to agree. Feel free to add your own perspectives on normalcy, especially from a Buddha perspective.
What you did is a description of how this ideal or livable society should be. Mm-hmm. So my question is how to get there? If Buddhadasa, he recommend or he said any way through activism, through politics, how he will say about it?
Yeah, personally, and I did ask him this question because it's very easy for the kind of things I said to be big ideals, and getting there isn't always easy. So, one specific response that he made when I asked him is through education. Now the problem with that is who runs education? In countries like this, it's largely the government. In my country, it's a little more complicated. But partly he felt is by developing education systems that can foster the ways of thinking, behaving, and so on along the lines I was speaking of. I tended to argue with him on that. I was a school teacher in Thailand, and my experience in the Ministry of Education, you know, in the Thai's top-down system, I didn't see a lot of room for that happening. Even when they tried to bring more Buddhism into the schools, it was often heavy-handed and insensitive to Muslims, for example. It was a big problem in the South. Maybe it still is. So I also want to point out that if you study how he lived, it was through personal example, through friendship. So what I was saying at the very end is not wait for the big social structures to change, but individually and by building friendships, looking for like-minded people, working together to build the foundations for these things. And so he seems supportive of both people in government, but later also NGOs who were trying to find alternative ways to foster a more livable society. And his way of encouraging them was to try to help ground their work in Dhamma. So there's not a lot of nuts and bolts in that. But I think he might say something like, it's up to each of us to find how we can contribute. His notion of duty is for each of us to be mindful enough of our own realities and then inspired by some of these teachings to then, for us to challenge ourselves to find out how to do these things in our lives. And that was a big part of his approach, is to, you know, encourage some perspectives and then say it's for each of us to find our own way to practice.
I got a question here. Listen to you on the your meaning of the livable society. I kind of have two things in mind. I myself have been educated overseas, so my thinking's always, you know, like American, like liberty, life, pursuit of happiness, you know, those kind of stuff. But in Thailand, we still have another value system, like love your nation, love monarchy, love a religion. That's like right now they have like 12 points. You know, love Thailand. I can go on a little bit, so you know. First is like love your nation, religion, monarchy. The second was be honest, sacrifice, patient. The third one was be respectful to your parents, your teacher. The fourth one was study more. The fifth one was to be conservative on your culture. The sixth was to be honest and morality. And the seventh, study democracy. Number eight is be disciplined and respect to the seniority. Number nine is mindfulness. Number 10 is learn to be self-sufficient. Number 11 was to be strong in your mind and your body. Don't give up to the gilet, you know. Mm-hmm. Number 12 is always think about the, I would say, society more than your personal. And so these 12 points that the government want the Thai people to have their value like this. Mm-hmm. And so that three system now in my mind, Western way, you know, all men created equal, self-evidence, all that. Also the Buddha Sa, I have a note too, like 10 points today. Mm-hmm. So as an ordinary man, what should I do now? Should I take some of them or just believe in one system or just...
Well, first, like to take life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, Ajahn Buddhadasa talked about those going back a long time. And so to really question, well, what is freedom? And he tried to distinguish between basically, to put it simply, freedom for the defilements and freedom from defilements. I feel in my country, a lot of the freedom is for the sake of defilement. Greed, hatred. You know, a lot of people are saying very ugly things. And selfishness and that kind of stuff. So for him, one, to take all of these and think carefully about what kind of freedom matters to you? what kind of freedom is wise. Pursuit of happiness depends on how you understand happiness. In my country, it seems the main understanding is happiness is to have a lot of stuff. Ajahn Buddhadasa, Paco and I and some others are finishing up a little booklet called Happiness and Hunger, and Ajahn Buddhadasa makes that distinction too. How do we understand happiness? And what is the point of, what is the purpose of life, the meaning of life? So, and then to do the same with those 12 points, many of them are derived from Buddhism. There are also things that when I was a school teacher in the 1980s, the principal would lecture the students. One of the problems was the teachers didn't exactly do it themselves. I don't know about the current government, but are they setting a good example? But not to worry about them too much, it's for us to investigate what these things mean, and then yes, choose using your own awareness, your own intelligence to find real compassion in your heart and make good choices. And I think if we do that, it's not a big deal whether it's some of it's from the West, some of it's from Confucianism, some of it's from Buddhism. But it's when we've chosen through our own intelligence and then commit. To me, that's the main thing. Because these lists, you know, it's easy for some authority to say, this is what we should do. But it won't happen until people commit. And in Buddhism, we're encouraged to think it through carefully before we make a commitment. But in principle, those 12 sounded pretty good.
Not many people are doing it.
Well, that's the trouble with Buddhism, too. So, but, you know, there's, at the end of, for his 80th birthday, Ajahn Buddhadasa made a special book to give to his students. Because everybody who came to the monastery for his 80th birthday, and Thai people make donations, tambun, and so they would get this gift. The short name is Asiti. And in that book, there's one section with pictures. Well, there are pictures all through the book with little captions. And one of them, there's two pictures. One, he's walking. He's old. He's got his cane. And he's walking on a path in Suan Mok. And it says, if I remember right, if nobody joins, then go alone. Meaning, just do your practice, do your duty. But then the next picture, you turn the page and he's looking back, but maybe there will be friends. So, that's what we can do. Every time we practice Dhamma in some way, we encourage others to. And that's what we can do, and we can't force people. And don't worry if you think it might take a long time. Time is an illusion anyway.
What do you think about Thailand education? You've been teacher before, right? You said
Yeah, but a long time ago.
Okay.
I'm not up on the situation now. So it's hard for me. I can comment on 20 years ago. I was a school teacher 1980 to 1984, so that was a while ago. But then, when I was a monk, I was involved in education in a variety of ways. I used to have more opinions, but now I'm more sanguine, more careful about how difficult it is to change culture. On the other hand, Ajahn Buddhadasa, by staying true to his understanding of Dhamma, inspired others and influences rippled outward and are still continuing.
Can you please illustrate more when he said Mahang Duan, education in Thailand? What was that? Than Put Thad thinking at that word?
Mahang Duan means a dog that's had its tail chopped off. And so if you've ever seen a dog that's trying to wag its tail, but it doesn't have a tail, it's incomplete. So the way he usually put it is, he felt that in general, modern Thai education, and this was 70s, 80s, he died in 93, was primarily about general knowledge. You learned how many provinces there are in Thailand, and maybe how many states there are in the US, and you memorize the periodic table and stuff like that, and you learned of vocation. So general knowledge and some kind of job training. But he felt Thai education was not really teaching people how to be human beings. And to be a human being had to do with a lot of the points I brought up tonight. A human being doesn't have to be trapped in competition. A human being can cooperate with others, make reasonable sacrifices for the common benefit. Practice Dhamma, practice meditation, think for oneself, and so on. And Thai education doesn't really encourage people to think for themselves. And nowadays, neither does an American education. Only the elite are encouraged to think for themselves. Especially if we include mass media when we talk about education. In the States, I think people get more education from mass media. Because when they're in school, they're just shutting off.
A couple of times you mentioned you're not too fond of the top-down system, but yet you used to live in southern Thailand, so in a traditional society, and as a monk, so it's expected that monasteries also follow a very traditional model and usually top-down. But I guess if you stayed so long, the monastery of Son Mok was a livable community, and if you please could you please illustrate a little more how Ajahn Buddhadasa made the Son Mok community livable, and in particular in regard to the top down or alternative model of Dhamma management.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a good question. One reason I stayed was because Ajahn Buddhadasa wasn't into telling people what to do. I think a long time ago, Thai monasteries were fairly egalitarian, but the Sangha Reform Act of, I think it was 1906, and even worse in something, 1951, 52, something, one of the military dictators, they made the Sangha much more hierarchical and top down than it used to be. So some of that was somewhat recent. Anyway, Ajahn Buddhadasa, like one simple example, when I was there, there were many Westerners and they weren't behaving properly according to Thai customs. And so I thought we should have rules to tell them, you know, what they should do and not do. And Ajahn Buddhadasa laughed. And his point was one, treat them like adults, give them the opportunity to look around and learn and adapt. And second, if they're too stupid to do that, then don't waste your time. And he was like that with, you know, he did his work at Suan Mok. He didn't put much energy into policing the monks. And so there was a lot of freedom, including to make mistakes. He did not expect the monks to teach exactly what he said. Once there was a library for the foreigners. There was this one building where we had a lot of books. And there was Buddhist stuff, and there was Hindu, and all kinds of things. And there were a couple books in there I thought were real bad. And I wanted to get rid of them. So I would go to him and say, oh, there's this really bad book. People shouldn't read this garbage. And then he looked at me, he said, yeah, you're right. You know what we should do? We should make a stamp and then in red, dangerous book. And then he looked at me with a little twinkle. So he was not interested in telling people what to read, what to do. To a certain degree, he abided by Thai customs. He didn't want to, you know, get people bent out of shape. But for example, when I would go to see him to talk, I would get on my knees and bow because I felt that was what I should do, and I was happy to do it. I really respected him. And then he would say, get up, sit on the bench, and we just sat there as two adults having a conversation. He was not interested. He didn't mind a certain amount of the formalities, but that wasn't important to him. So we can be respectful of the culture without making a big deal about that stuff. So that would be another way. When he was offered titles by the Sangha, they kind of come from the king, but who gets them is really internal monastic politics. He never once went to get his title. And there are a lot of monks who are buying these things. And his friend would go get it and then bring it down, but he never once went. And then later when he was being given some very senior titles, then somebody from the government would come down to give it to him. And he would politely say thank you and then give them a Dhamma talk. So there's all these ways he didn't really play into that stuff. It began to change after he died. Suan Mok was less like that after he died. Still an okay place, but... Or he would comment on the role that the dogs and the chickens played. No, in his perspective, everybody had a role and everybody should be respected for their contribution, including the dogs and chickens. And so he didn't think everybody was equal in the sense of having the same abilities. But everybody who contributed according to their abilities. There was a couple people who were mentally ill, but they had a job, they did it. Nobody caused them trouble. They were treated with respect. So those are some examples.
In a livable society, how does the notion of passing on, do you ever mention knowledge, that notion?
Class?
Class, yes.
I don't remember talking about class a lot. Part of the problem is in India they had the caste system, and it's not exactly the same as class. So, but I never heard him talk against the notion of social classes, because he had some students who were fairly high ranking, but not many at the very top. But some people who came from so-called good families and things. The point he stressed was that whatever social status or position one had, it should be used for the benefit of everyone. And he would acknowledge that that wasn't always happening. Part of the propaganda is the high-ranking people are always doing stuff for the good of the Thai people. And he knew that that was not always true. But I never heard him critique, or I didn't read of him critiquing class on its own. But he talked, like he talked about, he borrowed a, I think it was a communist phrase to plow rice fields on the backs of the poor. Thai na bon lang, konyak jon. So he would use phrases like that to, you know, if your class is businessman or merchant, you shouldn't be using that to exploit the farmers, the poor. So it would come up maybe in ways like that. But I think he accepted to a certain extent that things like class happen. And so he was less concerned with, say, getting rid of class. And I think he would have thought that that was impossible anyway. So the issue is more how the classes can cooperate for the benefit of all, meaning no class should be exploited for the benefit. You know, if one group is exploited supposedly for the benefit of society, it really means that that group is exploited for the benefit of certain groups. So that clearly was not Dhamma in his eyes. So nobody should be exploited. But it's normal that some people will have more money, but there shouldn't be anybody starving And I should also say, it seems to me he didn't see his social, or when it came to politics, and this came up once, there was an American journalist who came and interviewed him about politics. And Ajahn Buddhadasa said, politics is a branch of morality. And this journalist got very angry. He said, no, politics is about power. And he really got upset, because not to Ajahn Buddhadasa, but I was the one showing him around, and he was very angry with me. Ajahn Buddhadasa saw his role as not looking into the details of, say, a political system, but to try to point to Dhamma principles to incorporate in a political system. And it should be the politicians, the political scientists, the people who work in government to work out details. But he didn't have the knowledge to do that. Do I think? If modern education cares about that, but that's a social decision. And like in my country, it requires a social discussion. What are our moral values? And right now we just have people yelling at each other. You're narrow-minded. You know, you're immoral. And there's not a discussion. There's just a lot of name-calling, which is unfortunate. And then schools are now being abused by political agendas, rather than having a proper discussion. What are the values we want our schools to pass on to our children? Ajahn Buddhadasa felt that the Thailand, at least southern Thailand of his childhood, at the Wat and in the schools he went to as a child, he thought there was a pretty good job being done of teaching healthy values. And because home and the village and the Wat worked together, so there was the role that was played out at home in the village itself. And much of this has been dismantled by change in society. So it's a lot easier to see happening on the village level. It's harder to maybe imagine right now on a broader level. But that's why we have groups doing various education experiments, trying to find things that work. And there are some government schools that do a good job. I've known excellent teachers who, just by being good people who care about their students, pass on good values. But when it's official policy, then it often is just words, which doesn't change much. It's living examples. But my second school, when I got there, the headmaster was very corrupt and also stupid, so he got caught. And then we got a new one who was very good. And I was there for just a year or so, and many things started to change by just you know, some of the teachers were already good, they cared about their job, and then because, you know, Thailand is still pretty top down, it required a change at the top. But with a good headmaster, or not, Ajahn Yai, principal, there was some noticeable changes that lasted for some time.
So would you have a few words as a conclusion that would help us to go towards a livable society?
So I presented certain ideas, but basically it's for each of us to question deeply what is the kind of society we want to live in, and to have the courage to take steps each day to live that society. And that's our capacity as human beings. We can imagine, we can draw on resources like Buddhism, but we can imagine what is worthwhile. And to have the courage to ask the question, to imagine what's possible, and then to take a step, just one step at a time. Because practice is always now. It's not about the future. So we can imagine what's possible, and then we take another step. And in that way, we each create a livable society as much as we're able to.